of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Welcome to the November Town Board Meeting for the Town of Phillipstown. Approval of minutes, monthly town board meeting, October 7, 2021. A lot of feedback there. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye, vote aye. Public hearing, Local Law 1, October 7, 2021.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye, vote aye. Public hearing for the Local Law Number 2, October 7, 2021.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye, vote aye. Public hearing, Local Law Number 3, October 7, 2021.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
And I vote aye. Conservation Board, that's Jason, right? We'll get that, we'll hit that on rebound. Recreation.
Recreation did not meet last week because of the storm, but we did have a wonderful run on Saturday. The Recreation Commission and the Friends of Phillipstown Recreation and the Recreation Department.
Nice of you to join us.
Turned out and had a wonderful morning and afternoon with all the runners. And we want to thank everyone who participated. There were about 100 people, and about $5,000 was raised to finish the pavilion in Phillipstown Park. So thank you to everyone who participated. And we also, thanks to Bob, Councilman Flaherty's, rec center is currently in the process of getting ready for solar panels to be installed. So we're excited about that.
Yeah, definitely a good thing.
Yeah, it's a big deal too, long time coming.
It is.
Long time coming.
Yes.
All right, we're gonna jump back to Conservation Board. Thank you, Judy.
You're welcome.
Apologies for being a minute late.
Oh, yeah.
How are you? So the Conservation Board meeting on October 12th, they did formally request to the Planning Board that the Hudson Valley Shakespeare Festival project comes back before the Conservation Board. At that meeting on October 12th, the Hudson Valley Shakespeare Festival made an initial proposal on where the project stands. They noted that they will need a wetlands permit from the Conservation Board, and so they were scheduling another time to walk around with Conservation Board members on site, which has probably happened by now. We'll find out next week. They also had some conversation about how to make the property maintenance agreements that they sign with property owners part of the standard protocol, how to kind of make sure that they are enforced and that people are following them. And then they had a really interesting conversation in the context of a project that River Architects is working on related to, you know, in the past the Conservation Board has allowed for, you know, as they've granted exemptions to build something close to a wetlands boundary, they've often mitigated that by having property owners plant native species or that sort of thing. And there was a interesting conversation about, you know, should buildings that go up that include no fossil fuel energy systems, green roofs, solar, et cetera, count as how the Conservation Board thinks of a mitigation. So it was just an interesting conversation. And the next meeting is next Tuesday evening, this upcoming Tuesday.
Thank you, Jason. Phillipstown Hub.
The Phillipstown Hub did not have any meetings this month, but I just wanted to remind people that the Hub is here to serve everyone at 5 Stone Street, and you can also go to PhillipstownHub.org for more information. The Hub provides Phillipstown residents with a place in our community to access programs, services, and education related to mental health and addiction. And in the past year, the Hub has served over 142 people, a 136% increase during the pandemic. So we really appreciate having the availability of the Hub in our town.
Yeah, and I can't stress that enough. If you need help, help is available in Phillipstown. The resources are out there, and the Hub is a great place to start to get directed to the help you need. So. All right, thank you, Judy. Planning Board.
Planning Board, good evening, everybody. Planning Board was held October 21st, via Zoom.
a full agenda as it always been recently. The first thing in corresponding, they did review to all three local laws that we're going to be looking at this evening and either passing them. They okayed all of those. They were in agreement with them. New business, we had Audrey Sundless, 5 Jupiter Hill Road in Garrison, very new projects, a minor project, a redevelopment of a residential property with a new single-family dwelling to be served by a private septic system and a well in a two-car garage. They are going to do this referred to the county and the conservation board. The next thing on the agenda was Johnson's house on Mountain Brook Drive, Cold Spring, New York, tax map 16-1-34-56. This is a minor project as well as a single-family house dwelling served with a septic and a new well system as well. They're going to do a site visit on this coming Sunday at 10:30. Also, the last one I just discussed is having a site visit that day as well, 11-7 at 9:30. Under old business, Riverview, which we've discussed for well over a year, they're going to have a resolution for passing for next month. 3622 Route 9 in Cold Spring on Route 9, that's been through the planning board for quite some time as well. They approved that application as well. Last thing on the agenda was the Garrison Golf Course in Hudson Valley Shakespeare. They discussed the compliance of the AEF Part 3. There'll be a special meeting scheduled for this next Thursday night at 7 p.m. And the next planning board meeting is on the 18th at 7:30 via a Zoom. Thank you.
Thanks, Bob. All right. Zoning.
I attended the zoning meeting on October 4th via Zoom. There was two public hearings that evening, James and Christian Connolly, 51 Route 403 in Garrison. They were seeking seeking a variance for rear yard setback to install a swimming pool. That public hearing was held and closed and approved unanimously. John and Virginia Kelly, 3 Downey Lane in Cold Spring. They're seeking a variance to build a 312 square foot addition. The application proposes a 19 foot west side setback where 30 feet is required. That public hearing was opened and closed and approved unanimously also. There will be no meeting in November for the zoning board. There's nothing on their agenda. So the next planned meeting is January 10th via Zoom.
Wow, good.
Nice. Thanks, John. Highway.
Highway, I have that as well. Phillipstown Town Board members from Carl Frazenda. Work performed by the Phillipstown Highway Department for the month of October. This month, the crews have been regrading dirt roads, which had finally been finished prior to Storm Ida. Time was also spent clearing waterways late in the month prior to the nor'easter, which brought heavy rains and winds. Update on the new highway garage. After storm delays, digging for the footings has begun and will be poured as soon as conditions are right. The garage slab will be following soon after that. The new fueling system is awaiting DEC approval and registration. They must regulate pumps prior to usage, hopefully soon. We have received numerous calls in reference to dead trees. We are prioritizing tree work and trying to get all those which are most dangerous. We are asking residents to follow the town code and not blow leaves onto the town road. By doing so, it could cause dangerous situations for motorists as well as drainage problems. Please dispose of leaves properly. The highway department received approximately 25 phone calls and emails regarding road complaints and issues for the month of October. Roughly $3,800 was spent in vehicle maintenance and repairs for the month of October. Submitted by Carl Frazenda, Highway Superintendent.
All right, thank you to you and Carl. Building and land acquisition. I guess you just heard about the highway garage. That's one item. And then thanks to Councilman Flaherty, we're about to have solar on the rec roof. I guess the materials were dropped off?
Yep, the materials were dropped off the other day. They plan on starting to work next Monday. And they said it should be finished in about two and a half weeks.
Wow, we'll be up and running?
Pretty close to that, yeah.
Commission?
Yeah.
Wow, this
That's
is a big deal.
Great step, yeah.
Amazing, thank you.
We can't thank you enough, Bob, the amount of effort. This has been going on for probably-
Five years.
At least, and it was so complex to get
Maybe
that
more, yeah.
thing wrapped up and get it installed. Yeah, since you were here when it started,
yes.
at least. So it's quite an accomplishment.
Thank you. It's a pleasure, it was a long process, but we got through it, and it's going to be a good thing for our community. Just another step in the right direction from going green, as our community is. So it's a big accomplishment for everybody in our community.
All right, thanks. Cemetery Committee.
The Cemetery Committee, the only news to report is that I had a conversation with Susan Kenny about the budget left in the Cemetery Committee, because there's work that the Cemetery Committee wants to continue doing in terms of repairing old gravestones. And so Susan let me know that there's roughly about $2,000 left in this year's budget after the last mowing bill. And so I think I'll relay that information to the Cemetery Committee and ask for a work plan, if there's anything that can be done between now and the end of the year related to that, if that sounds okay with everybody.
Yeah, I have to step it up.
Yeah.
You get cold.
Yeah.
Cold this morning. All right, thank you, Jason.
Yep.
Putnam County Legislator.
Here comes Nancy.
Congratulations. Thanks. On making the front page of the PCNR in your leopard skin.
I am not wearing leopard print. I'm sorry.
Nancy, growl.
Oh.
Right. We had two cougars on the front.
That was so good. I knew as soon as I said yes, you could take my picture, that I was going to end up on the front page.
Oh, yeah.
I should have known better. I still have not learned my lesson.
Looking stylish.
Right where you belong.
And that is front page news.
Thank you. All right.
You're welcome.
So, congratulations, Supervisor-elect John Van Tassel and Councilman-elect Jason Angel.
Thank you.
Looking forward to working with you, and we'll save goodbyes for some other time. Really excited about this local government, group that we have here, and I know we're going to do great work. I'm here to answer any questions. I just wanted to give you a quick report on the budget, which you've probably already read about. We passed a $167 million budget. I voted no. What I saw was a $3.8 million or 2.3% increase during a time where our revenues have far exceeded our expenses, I think to about $43 million. Now, we can't say that's a surplus, but, we've had $43 million that we haven't, we saw in revenue over the past two budgets. So no other county in the area is raising taxes. Dutchess is actually cutting taxes. So
Westchester cut taxes.
So yeah, my question was, why are we raising taxes? I see a budget of increase in salaries for the upper management and the elected officials, and decrease in services, as you know, because we witnessed that ourselves in this district. Throughout the budget process, I did advocate to restore the Marine unit several times. The funding that they removed for garbage removal to assist with tourism in the village, they removed that when I got elected. I asked them to restore that, and I also asked them to provide funding for the hub. We had Danielle come in the month before and give a great presentation, and everybody's been aware of the hub at the legislature for a long time because I've been talking about it. And I also advocated for them to restore the civil sergeant's position at the sheriff's department. Those requests were all denied throughout the budget. Up until the last minute, I was requesting that. So I tried. I'll continue to do that. They did create a new funding line, last minute funding line, for requests that came in at the last minute from Vinnie Tamagna of the Constitution Island Association for $10,000. No program presented, sight unseen, just an ask, and it was received. So, unfortunately, we don't have support for our only mental health facility, public safety, and health for garbage removal. But that's the end of the budget discussion, unless you have more questions. I don't know. I still don't have a plan from the county executive for what's going to happen with the $19 million. Requested that as well. So any any questions you may have, I'm happy to answer now or find out for you.
Well, it defies logic that the county to the north is cutting taxes, the county to the south is cutting taxes, and Putnam's having a record-breaking year with revenue and raising taxes. It just doesn't... people do not follow this stuff, and
no.
they don't appeal to their own self-interests, and it's, you know, I just don't understand it. I really don't. And the fact that, look, we support Constitution Island, that's great, but what kind of process was there for this $10,000? If they're going to hand out $10,000, nobody hands us $10,000.
Yeah, what was the line that was cut for the garbage? It was like $2,000, wasn't it?
$7,500.
And they eliminated that.
So they eliminate garbage collection for the village where we're generating all this sales tax.
Yeah.
And yet somehow come up with $10,000 for, you know,
to bring more people through that we can't handle anyway.
Yeah, for Vinnie Tamanian is, you know, can we catch the bus down there?
There is no bus, sorry.
Oh, no bus, that's right. I forgot, transportation director. I'm not sure.
So I'll continue to, you know, find out where the money's going. I, too, wish that people were more aware and paid more attention. I wish maybe the press did some better coverage about these issues as they come up, and I guess I'll have to control my own messaging and continue to communicate with you guys and create my own forum to make sure the message gets out, because people are unaware, and I try my best to get the word out, but it's like if...
And you do a wonderful job. We appreciate
thank
it.
Thank you.
We do appreciate it. I mean, there is this complete lack of accountability on the county's, you know, behalf. And if it weren't for you pointing it out,
well,
no one would know.
It all appears wonderful over there, and it's just not the way I see it. I'm sorry. I ask questions. I don't get answers. I want to know where the funding went. I want to know what happened to the horses. I want to know what the funding, how did this, you know, 1950 something thing get restored? Who paid for that? You know, I want to know. It's just I need to tell you guys where it came from. Where did the money come from? Where does it go? That's all. It's that simple.
We'd be happy too if we had a $43 million surplus too.
Ooh, you're smiling.
$10,000 for the hub would be nice. Or some public safety.
Yeah, it's crazy, but thank you.
Thanks for listening, and any questions, I'm here.
Thanks
for the update. Here we go.
The first item on the agenda is a resolution adopting local law number 1, 2021, entitled A Local Law to Opt Out of the New York State Cannabis Law, Chapter 7A of the Consolidated Laws of the State of New York in regard to retail sales and in regard to establishment for on-site consumption, and this is a roll call vote.
Okay. We had a public hearing on this local law. You know, it was well attended, but, you know, I haven't been swayed, and in following the news on this, you know, it appears that there's plenty of time to consider this. In the coming year, because there won't be any licenses issued in 2022. There will not be cannabis licenses issued in New York State in 2022. Maybe 2023, I don't know. But it's not happening this year. So anybody who's running around with their head on fire saying that we're gonna fall behind and it's all gonna be, all the customers are gonna be taken, that's not happening. So if people wanna put this to a permissive referendum, put it out to the public, just as the village did, you know, that's really the way to go. We'll get a better feeling of how things are in town. But, you know, I'm still very much in favor of opting out at this time, just because of the fact that we don't have a handle on the administrative aspect of this, nor is there a whole lot of information out there as to how it's going to be handled. I mean, the board that's been empowered by the state of New York regarding administration and taxation for this program is just getting started. So there are no rules and regulations in place at this point. There's no real governing body that's going to be taking up this task. It's in a nascent stage. So I would, you know, advise everyone who came to the public hearing, we really appreciate what they, you know, brought in and everybody's opinion, but, you know, don't panic. we have a year to consider this or more. And if you want to, you know, sort of follow the process as it goes along in Albany at the state level, which is the governing body for this, then, you know, I would advise you to do that and come back informed. And if it does go to permissive referendum, you know, to have the facts about what this entails. So anything from the board?
Yeah. My view on this is completely different, and I think it's because I'm the father of two teenagers. I have two teenagers, and there's no way I have the ability or the want to endorse the sale and or on-site consumption of cannabis. Smoking in any form, and I know there's other ways to consume cannabis, but I just don't feel that smoking is a healthy thing to promote, and as a father, I cannot support it. So I also totally in supporting of opting out of it.
And there's still a very, you know, lively debate taking place with regard to not only this law, but the consumption of cannabis. And I know Judy's pointed out your concerns. I mean, Judy, if
yes,
you want to give voice to that.
I'm a parent, but I've also talked to a lot of parents in Phillipstown. I've talked to families. I've talked to recovering addicts. I've talked to the schools and the community organizations and mental health experts. And, you know, I'm concerned for them and all the residents of Phillipstown. I understand that entrepreneurs see this as a great opportunity, but I think our role is to look at the impact on our town. And we're already seeing the impact of substance abuse from alcohol abuse, from opioids. We founded, under the leadership of Supervisor Shea and legislator Nancy Montgomery, the Phillipstown Hub to support families in their battles with addiction. So for me, I'm at this time supporting opting out because I don't think our youth especially need easy access to one more substance. We know they have access to alcohol. We know they have access to tobacco and vaping. And all of these manufacturers said they were not going to market to youth, and they did. So if you say marketing's not going to happen for our youth and that it's going to be regulated and there's going to be enforcement, I don't believe that at this time.
I guess I would like to make some comments as well. This is actually, it's been a complicated issue for me to think through. And so I wanted to kind of relay some of my thinking before we vote. I'm personally open to a retail cannabis dispensary in Phillipstown. I think that, I know with liquor stores, liquor became more highly regulated. I think of retail dispensaries much like liquor stores, especially in New York State, with it being legalized. You know, I with liquor and cannabis, I personally have enjoyed both. And I've also learned, and this is what I want to focus on, that, any abuse of any substance is very bad for your health. And I have family members that have had alcohol addictions, and I know that, I think we should be focused on, it is going to be out there because of the legalization in New York State. And I think we really need to focus on that message that, that all of these things in excess are dangerous for you, whether it's alcohol, whether it's cannabis, whether it's something else. I think that I had a conversation with Great Barrington, which did this, and you know, they relayed that really their top concern, because crime didn't go up and the drug use by young people didn't go up, was vehicle traffic, because it's a different type of business. I always thought personally, although it's Cold Spring Village's business, that Main Street wasn't the best spot for this sort of thing because they already have difficulties with parking and vehicle traffic. But as we all know, it went to referendum, and that referendum showed, I think, is this right, that the voters approved retail cannabis in Cold Spring?
I don't know if it's official.
Too close to call.
Yeah.
I mean, It shows that it's still, from my vantage point, a very mixed, people have very mixed feelings about it, you know, still in the community. And that's important, you know, regardless of what my own feelings are about it. And I'll wrap up. I mean, I think it's positive that it would set, this is not the reason to do it. I think it's positive that it would set a precedent. It would force the county to share sales tax. And anytime they get into the habit of doing that, it's probably a good thing that they would have to figure out how to share it locally, which is something that I know that we all care about, especially because they are overflowing with money and we have lots of local community needs. And I think that's a positive. And I think, you know, I agree with Richard, it's all up in the air. And so I don't feel like we need to rush this, because I feel like if, you know, we talk to Cold Spring and Nelsonville and there's further community conversations and there's a way to do a retail dispensary in a way that addresses local concerns, then we can do that in the future. And there is no need to rush into it and to feel that pressure. And finally, I would just guess I'd say that, you know, while I am open to a retail dispensary, I don't feel open to an on-site consumption spot. And, you know, that's for a few reasons. One, it's because this New York State law allows people to smoke cannabis now wherever you can smoke cigarettes. Right. And so an on-site consumption cafe just seems like there's already so much going on with cannabis that there's no need to move in that direction. And it goes further than liquor. I mean, I can't go into a liquor store and pop open a bottle on the street when I come out. And you can now do that with cannabis. So I'm not for on-site consumption at this point. And so I'm, you know, and this local resolution that we're voting on to opt out is for both retail and consumption. And I wouldn't feel comfortable approving consumption at this point. So I think I will be opting out as well.
All right.
I wanted to make my points before.
No. Yeah. Thanks for clarifying. Yeah.
Myself, I was on the fence for this for quite some time. And, you know, we had a public hearing. We got feedback from positive and negative as well. My feeling is this. I mean, people who are going to use cannabis, they don't get it here in Cold Spring or Phillips Center, they're going to go someplace else. But still, with that being said, I think Richard made a good point. It's a little bit early here. We don't know exactly how everything's going to play out in the long run right now. So I think it's safe right now to opt out at this particular time. Again, I think if further down the road, we get better guidance from the state and so forth like that, and the public get enough people interested in bringing this forward to us, we'll be open to that. So at this particular time, I'm planning on opting out as well.
Okay. All right, thank you. All right, could I get a motion on the resolution to opt out of the... this will be a roll call. Councilman Van Tassel.
I vote in favor of opting out.
Opting out. Councilman Flaherty.
I vote aye.
Councilwoman Farrell.
I vote aye to opt out.
Councilman Angel.
I vote aye to opt out.
And I vote aye to opt out. Phillipstown opts out. I'm sure this is not the end of the discussion.
Well, again, I think when we had the public hearing, we did have a lot of people show up, which was good, right?
Yeah.
It's always good to get input from the public. And I think it was about, to be honest, I think it was close to 50-50, about for and against. It was pretty close.
Yeah.
Again, down the road, bring it forward to us and we can get it on the ballot.
Yeah, it takes a little work, not a lot, but they did it in Cold Spring, so. It can be done in Phillipstown, at least to get it on the ballot. But at least then it goes to a democratic process, and it's not just the five of us making the final determination.
If it doesn't go to ballot at any time, the town board could propose a local law to and opt back in. Isn't
we can
that right?
opt back Even in. It's just it's the only opportunity you have now to opt out and consider the, you know, the ramifications of opting in.
Yeah.
So it also seems prudent to do it because opting in now, that's it. Our role is essentially over. It goes to, you know, we still have zoning and things like that, but by opting out, we keep our options open and it can go to permissive referendum. It can come back to the town board. There's more time for discussion. So I think it's a...
Yeah, I think this got kind of rushed too on us. You know, they talked about it, but then we really didn't get a time to get in front of everybody. And it's just, I don't think we had enough time for everybody involved to really you know, make a good determination. I think it's the right thing to do what we're doing now. We've got more time to think about it. And like I said, we can always opt in whenever the time comes.
Yeah, these are complicated and nuanced discussions. It's not the sort of thing you can rush into. So, and I know there's people sitting home saying, look at these old fogies are acting like Puritans, blah, blah, blah. You know, it's like, no, that's not the case. There are smart, thoughtful people on the town board, and we consider the issues for the entire town. It's because we get 15 people show up at a meeting, and you know, there's passionate discussion and people telling us we don't know or something from a hole in the ground. We do. You can be confident. There's been a lot of work here in the last two decades. So, moving right along.
Next is a resolution making a negative declaration under CECRA in regard to Local Law Number 2, 2021, entitled A Local Law to Add a New Section 175-18.2, entitled Upland Drive and Ridge Road Development Districts. And this again is a roll call.
Here we have it. We did have a public hearing on this very issue. This is to address the concerns of development in Continental Village in general, but mostly on Upland Drive, just because of the nature of the road, if you want to call it a road. So forming this development district, we felt like was important. It's going to give us more tools to deal with development. So I don't know if the board wants to add anything to that. The one thing I will say is I had, that night we had discussed writing a letter to the county executive. I did draft that letter. It's gone out. So it's on her desk, or it should be there. I don't know. Anyone who wants a copy of this letter, just really relating the event that took place or the events that took place at the public hearing, talking about increasing pressure for homes, increasing pressure to develop, substandard conditions down there, just laying out the whole case for being cautious about development on that road and our wish that the county would not sell off lots on that road. So I'll wait to hear back. I'm sure that the county executive and I will be discussing this, but I ended with, I'd be happy to hear your thoughts on the matter and await your response. I'm available by, gave her my cell phone, so she's got all my information.
I have a question on it, Richard. Yeah. It says under number one on the declaration page, maximum density is decreased from 1 acre to 2 acres. Should that be increased?
Well, or maximum density
is decreased, it says.
Yeah, so it says is decreased from 1 to 2.
I thought there was
so it's less dense.
Less dense. Okay.
So you have less density of development. So you're increasing the lot size and decreasing density.
Okay. Thank you.
It is.
That is all confusing, though.
It is.
And then the next line says increase from 1 acre to 2 acres.
Right. So you're decreasing density by increasing the requirement for acreage.
I was just going to report, and I know all the town board members, we had a discussion about this, that at the public hearing, a number of residents of Upland Drive and the surrounding area, believed that moving from 1 acre to 2 acres was not enough, mostly because, they've stated that there's 71 acre lots that could be developed, and that would, even if it was 2 acres, that would still be a lot of road traffic. And just to report back, we asked the question to Steve Gaba, the town's council, who said, he really did advise that further upzoning beyond 2 acres could be explored in the future, but that this is the right move right now because there's a moratorium on development that's expiring. Steve Gaba said that, that upzoning to a further, acreage could be explored once the comprehensive plan is approved, because that's going to require looking at updating zoning laws, just
right,
to
so
report that.
There'll be a more comprehensive look at zoning townwide at that point once again. But it is important to get a law on the books in the interim. And, if you're talking about 71 lots down there, 71 one-acre lots, they're not all contiguous. They're broken up. So, to really get the data on that would be a little tricky. That's something somebody have to dive into.
And also steep slopes. There's so many local zoning codes that would have...
Right, mitigating things. You know, getting 35-plus additional lots down there, it's just not going to happen. Yeah, and that's just the beginning of, you know, other considerations in these laws. So, yes, sir. Mr. Waxman, how are you? You want to speak into the microphone?
I'd like to comment on three points. One is the upzoning that Mr. Angel brought up. And I gave you the math and so on. And it's very easy for a developer who has one lot to buy an additional one next to him. So it's not like all these 70 people will do it individually. So this is something to consider. Two other points. One is the planning board has discretion to waive requirements. But when they gather information, they should gather true information. With Campbell, they just took his word. He just lied. He said the road is perfectly fine. You all were on the road. You know it's not true. He said he spoke to us, and we said the road is okay. We came. We found out after the fact that he said that. He did not. He did not talk to people, and on. I don't want to go through the whole laundry list. I can supply it to you. So I want it to be somehow encoded that the planning board, when they accept something as a fact, they have to prove it. They have to know. They can't just take somebody's word that I declare to be so. And I will give you a list of the details that we think should be done. The third thing is something that was not considered at all, which is the maintenance of the road. Now, everybody has to pay for maintaining roads. People who live on a town road pay it through their taxes. People who live in a private development pay it through their entity that runs the private development. We are unique that the road doesn't belong to anybody. We, on our own, take care of it. So we don't have the obligation to make it to non-road standards. But the guy who's going to get a building permit, a new one, has to do that. So it's not a one-time thing where he gets it to get going. It has to be maintained for the lifetime of the house. So that is their responsibility. So this has to be legislated that they have to do it. It should be determined by a road engineer because of the road condition itself destructs. It has to be determined how it has to be maintained. And if they don't maintain it, the highway department should do it and charge him. I'll give you the details, but something, I'm assuming the town wants to make something to settle this for the foreseeable future. In other words, this is something new. So I will give you the details what we came up with. And at this point, you know, we go with it, but there's going to be, like Mr. Angel mentioned, there's going to be new rethinking. So I think that should be part of it.
Thank you.
I just want to say one thing. When the planning board, every time there's an application for the planning board, they do a site visit on almost every single application. So if someone did come through the planning board in this area, they do have a site visit, and they go down and look at it. And beforehand, they know if it's a steep slope or so forth like that. So the planning board won't make any decisions until they actually see the property itself.
But that wasn't done before. It wasn't done with the Campbell House. For example, I looked through all the whereases. There were some 23 before they gave him a building permit. And one of them was there was a public hearing. There were no public hearing for that. You know, we live on the road, we would have known. Oh, this is another point. When somebody applies for building permit, there should be a public hearing so we can come and say what we know for a fact how the road is.
Well, I think, you know, like I said, the planning board, maybe that application, if it didn't go through the planning board, then they would definitely wouldn't be aware of it and wouldn't be doing a site visit. But if there were steep slopes involved, it has to go before the planning board. So it should be. I mean, okay. A lot of times, like, you know, in big projects, maybe the single-family house isn't considered a big project, but even single-family houses, and there's a lot of contentions in areas, they do have a public hearing. In most cases where it's, you know.
Okay, but we have to know about them. And nobody notified this. The first thing we knew is that there was a big posted notice on a tree at the entrance to his lot that he has a permit. Nobody knew anything before.
Well, again, I don't know too much about that.
I'm giving you a fact.
Mr. Waxman, it sounds like you were referring, though, to we're in the resolution on the upzoning of the acreage, but it sounds like you were referring to the road standards and the idea that the planning board could waive the road standards.
Right. Yeah. I don't know. I don't have the scalpel to cut apart this LL from the other one, so I just thought that I would
bundle it. You know, again, the planning board can't waive bulk standards. They can't waive the requirements that are set forth in zoning. Someone would have to apply for a variance before the ZBA. Between these two laws, I think that the concerns are pretty well addressed.
As you heard earlier, we were
talking about addressing road maintenance agreements. So that's also coming before the Conservation Board. So these things are all being taken up. It's just that for now, with the moratorium about to expire.
I get that. But how did Camp, none of us can figure out how he got his permit. He asked the fire department, because he assumed the fire department knows the roads, they should give him a certificate. The road is okay, it has good and adequate access. The fire department wrote him a formal letter from their attorney that they are not road engineers and they're not qualified to make a judgment on that. But their coming up means nothing. They will go up even when there's no road. Their job is to save houses. Then he wrote the fire department, you know, if you come up and I fix this, will it help you? They said yes. And this is what the planning board accepted. So it's beyond us. I'm not going to bore you now with all the details. I can furnish them to you. They made 23 whereases. I don't believe the Constitution has 23 whereases, you know, just to come to a resolution. Okay, anyway, so I'm good with this. You know, let's pass this now, and then with the other time, you know, we'll put everything together.
This is a big step, in addressing those concerns that you have going forward. I understand the issue with the one house, but we're not here to relitigate that one house. That's not within our purview.
Right. Sorry to see you go. Happy to see you come.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, with that, unless there's any other comment on the local law, could I get a motion on the resolution to adopt the local law creating the Upland Drive and Ridge Road?
This is the resolution for
SECR. Oh,
it's
for SECR. Oh,
neg deck,
geez.
And then
we'll. The neg deck. Sorry about that. Could I get a motion on the neg deck?
So moved.
And this isn't roll call for this. It is.
It is.
Okay. Councilwoman Farrell.
I vote aye.
Councilman Van Tassel.
I vote aye.
Councilman Flaherty.
Aye.
Councilman Angel.
Aye.
And I vote aye. We adopt the neg deck.
Next is the resolution adopting local law number 2/2021 entitled a local law to add a new section 175-18.2 entitled Upland Drive and Ridge Road Development Districts. And this again is a roll call.
Here we go. See you, Mr. Waxman. Can I get a motion on the resolution?
So moved.
Second.
We have a roll call. Councilman Angel.
Aye.
Councilman Flaherty.
Aye.
Councilman Van Tassel.
Aye.
Councilwoman Farrell.
Aye.
And I vote aye. There we go.
Next is a resolution making a negative declaration under SECRA in regard to local law number 3/2021 entitled a local law to amend Town Phillipstown Town Code Chapter 112-35 and the Open Development Area General Regulations of Chapter 112, Article 8, in regard to standards for development of private roads. And again, this is a roll call.
So a public hearing was held on this. We did have a lively discussion about it. It seemed like people hadn't read either law, which makes it difficult to have the discussion. But if you follow these laws, I think they really do a solid job of addressing the concerns that everyone has. And, you know, everyone's looking at worst case scenario. There's 30 additional lots, that's going to mean 60 houses. Well, there are just so many extenuating circumstances. Even without these laws, I don't think you're ever going to see that kind of development, that level of development, just because of the fact that, as John said, you have this mitigating circumstances, just steep slopes that would have to be addressed.
Trying to get a septic in.
The rocky areas that you have. You need Board of Health approval. You need a lot of things before you can even, prior to this, build a house down there. and the fact that the road is just really not the most inviting area. So adding these additional regulations, I think, really is going to address most of the concerns down there while still respecting property owners' rights. Again, we're asking that the county not sell these lots off. It certainly seems that they're not hurting for money at this point, so I can't see any rational reason, rather than, you know, punitive against the town of Phillipstown, that they would go and sell these lots. They're not going to generate a lot of income out of that, and I will be discussing that with the county executive, so I'm sure they'll help us out in that respect. But with that, I mean, I know the board's had this. We've had a chance to look at the local law, so now we can adopt the neg deck again, yeah. So could I get a motion on the resolution adopting negative declaration for this amendment?
So moved.
Second.
Councilwoman Farrell.
I vote aye.
Councilman Flaherty.
Aye.
Councilman Van Tassel. Councilman Angel.
Aye.
And I vote aye. There we have it, the neg deck for the road standards.
Next is a resolution adopting local law number 3/2021, entitled a local law to amend Town of Phillipstown Town Code Chapter 112-35 and the Open Development Area General Regulations of Chapter 112, Article 8, in regard to standards for development of private roads. And again, it's a roll call vote.
Right, so this is a short but very comprehensive law. Again, addressing, you know, not only Mr. Waxman's concerns, but anybody who stood up that evening. I think if they take a look at this, they're going to find that their concerns have been addressed and the needs are being met on both sides. So any further discussion on this? I think we've had a good go around with it. Could I get a motion on the resolution adopting local law and enacting amendments to the open development area regulations?
So moved.
Roll call. Councilman Van Tassel.
Aye.
Councilman Flaherty.
Aye.
Councilwoman Farrell.
Aye.
Councilman Angel.
Aye.
And I vote aye. There we go. This is government in action. Aye, Seal.
Excuse me. Next is a resolution authorizing the board to waive the bidding defect of failure to timely submit a non-collusion form, a signed non-collusion form, from Intercounty Paving Company Incorporated in regard to the 2022 highway material bid for bituminous concrete furnished, delivered, and laid in place, and awarding that bid to Intercounty Paving Co.
This was just an oversight on an office worker's behalf. We're not looking to remove a low bidder, qualified low bidder, who subsequently supplied the non-collusion form. It's just, this is a minor issue. We do want to take the low bids, and we do want to be fair to people at the same time. So we're not going to disqualify somebody on the basis of a minor technicality when they supplied this thing. I don't know, they were a couple hours late or something like that with it, or the next day.
I think it was within an hour.
Within an hour.
She left here, realized it, and called us immediately when she got back to the office and supplied the signed form. So.
Yeah, so we certainly don't want to cost anybody their job over something like that either. So, I strongly advise that we go ahead and adopt this resolution. Any discussion? It's a minor issue. All right.
It's another roll call vote, just so you know. Sorry.
All right. Could I get a motion on the resolution?
So.
Second.
Second.
Roll call. Let's go to Councilman Angel first.
Aye.
Councilman Flaherty.
Aye.
Councilman Farrell.
Aye.
Councilman Van Tassel.
Aye.
And I vote aye. There we have it. Grinder now.
Next is a resolution approving the following one change order for the proposed Highway Department headquarters in the amount of $17,675, and that's for additional rock removal for the general contractor, ML Inc.
And so it begins. We don't have any way around this. They did provide an allowance for rock removal and then a per yard price for rock removal. That we did run into additional rock at the highway garage site.
What a surprise in Phillipstown. We hit extra rock.
You don't find a lot of dirt. You do find a lot of rock.
There's a ledge right behind it.
Yeah, and that ledge came right down. So we don't have a way around that, but It is a sizable increase to start with, but...
Well, you know, a lot unknown sometimes when you get into construction.
Don't I know it. Every day. All right, could I get a motion on that resolution approving that change order?
So moved.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
And I vote aye.
Next on the agenda is to schedule any workshops or meetings. We have the budget adoption, which is November 17th. We have the regular monthly meeting, which is December 2nd. And then we have a workshop request from Ashley Roush at HHLT to discuss the funding feasibility study. And they want to do that over Zoom sometime late November. So I was looking at either the 17th or the 24th.
Well, 17th, we're doing the budget adoption.
So then the 24th. Which
unless,
I know it's the week.
Unless we all want to gather around the screen here.
That's the Wednesday before Thanksgiving.
The 24th is, yeah.
That's Thanksgiving Eve?
Yes.
Yes.
Well, I'll be out tearing it up that day.
Can I ask the consultant to thank you December 1st? Is that
right? Yeah. I mean,
well,
that's...
Well, but see, Zoom, that gives us a little bit more flexibility.
That would be helpful. Do we want to say tentatively we'll pencil in December 1st?
Sure.
All right, that'd
just
be swell.
Let me know.
Yeah, there's one consultant from Florida who, I'm sure would love to come up to the morning.
Yeah. Yeah, especially if they could get up here, you know, Thanksgiving evening, hit the clubs.
So we'll ask about December 1st and when we'll be able to let you know
if that
does. Okay. Other than that, all this looks fine. December 2nd. Although we got the year-end.
No, we'll have the year-end, yeah.
Yes, everybody loves you, but I won't be. That's just so much fun. All right.
The highlight of your year.
Yes. Close out the books.
Next on the agenda is the code enforcement monthly report, and this is for October. Total fees collected, $20,655. Ooh. There were 25 total permits issued. One new one or two family dwelling, one addition, alteration, or repair to residential buildings, 23 all other permits, including pools, decks, sheds, plumbing, HVAC, 36 certificates of occupancy, one stop work order, three inspections of public assembly.
Public assembly, what's that? That raises hairs, right? Hairs. All right. Anything else from the town board?
Supervisor Shea, I'd just like to wish everyone a happy Veterans Day coming up soon, next week, and thank our veterans for their service.
Absolutely. Well, we all know one. Yeah. We know plenty of them.
Yes.
So, thank you. Thanks for bringing that up, Judy.
Richard, the only question I had was, I don't think it's urgent. We discussed doing potentially an oral resolution to make the Phillipstown Trails Committee a official Phillipstown Advisory Committee. Did you want to do that or wait until December meeting?
Well, I mean, I don't see any harm in doing it right now. I mean, if people want to volunteer, and it certainly is something we'd like people to work on, getting more pedestrian friendly routes to places around town. We've discussed it. They've appeared before us. We've had correspondence back and forth. We're just going to empower a group to get together under the auspices of the town. Does the board have any,
They've already done a tremendous amount of work.
Yeah, they have on their own. Right. So, yeah, I mean, if I get a motion on a verbal resolution or a resolution here authorizing the Trails Committee to come under the auspices of the town of Phillipstown.
So moved.
Jason?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
I vote aye. Our thanks to anyone who wants to volunteer for the town, especially with that. It's, there's a lot of work that needs to be done to get pedestrian friendly routes around town, especially between the village and the farmers market, for starters. So, great.
Let them know, and I know they said that they will be overseeing the feasibility study through Hudson River Valley Greenway, and we'll report back to the board. So, thank you.
Cool.
I'd just like to wish everybody and their families a happy Thanksgiving coming up in the next couple weeks. Still encourage everyone to get vaccinated, and those who are eligible for the booster shot, I encourage that as well.
And your flu shot.
Oh, yeah, flu shot.
Get it all.
What is going on?
Kelly moved. Oh, Kelly's on the other side of the wall.
She Kelly, will you stop?
I don't think she's moved the whole time.
I thought she was tap dancing. Anything from the audience?
Did you guys vote on the marijuana resolution tonight yet?
We did. It was a little more complex than that. We are opting out for the time being. We don't anticipate that there will be any licenses issued in, we know they won't be happening in 2021. It doesn't appear that it will be happening in 2022, so that gives us time to consider the ramifications, you know, set the stage to where if it were going to happen in this town, where it would happen, how we regulate it. It's a complicated issue. Also to put it out to the people to take it up as a permissive referendum to put it on the ballot so we could vote on it. So for now, we are opting out until we can get our feet under us and get it, you know, established how we would deal with it if it comes along.
And the ramification of opting out is what?
It just gives us more time to consider the issue. We can always opt back in, but once you, if you don't opt out now, that's the last chance you have for opting out. So there's no further discussion, then it's up to the state of New York to tell us how it's done, where it goes. We, you know, really have no way to regulate it.
Well, congratulations to anybody who got elected.
Thank you.
All right, Carl. Thanks.
Just one other thing. We're getting closer to getting a new well, a temporary test well drilled down at the Garrison Water District as well. Just waiting for one more thing. We should hopefully get this started in the next 2 weeks.
Yeah, I'm glad Councilman Flaherty brought that up, because I know there's an incredible amount of frustration down there. You know, no one's more frustrated or concerned about this than the members of the town board. There's been a tremendous amount of work done to take care of this issue, to make sure that we have a reliable source of water for the Garrison Landing Water District. It worked for 18 years. The only thing that changed down there was the consumption. And, you know, we don't have leaks in the system. We have leak detection. We know we don't have that. We have the same supply we always had. We have the same system we always had. It's just consumption is up dramatically. People need to be aware that they need to conserve water. But, and I know private homeowners down there are aware of that. But, you know, when you have commercial applications that use a lot more water, and we're talking about, you know, double or triple what the consumption would normally be for a household. That's hard to keep up with on a system that works on, you know, a shoestring budget and on the margins where productivity is concerned. So we are going to go ahead and drill a new well. You know, Councilman Flaherty referred to it as a test well. It's only a test well in the sense that if we hit good water, we need to test the quality of that water, and then we have some other work to do. But we are moving ahead on it, and we're hoping to get that well drilled before the snow flies.
Once I have some firm dates, I know, well, we had a couple residents want to see that schedule. I don't want to put a schedule together until I know it's finalized. So once I have that, it will be published.
Right, so, and we have very limited options. We're going on to a property that's not owned by the town of Phillipstown. It's owned by the Open Space Institute, and they've been working with us in good faith. There are other people involved, you know, potential leasee or leaser of the Highland Country Club. But, you know, we're in a desperate position because we can only collect $18,000 a year from the entire district. That includes operations, maintenance, and capital improvement. It doesn't even cover debt service on the system that we, you know, funded 19 years ago now. So that's via the state of New York, only allows us to collect that amount of money. So it's an impossible situation. We don't have enough money to go ahead and do a major capital improvement on that. So we're going to take some American Rescue Plan money and put it into this. We know we have to do something. There are plans in the works. We have the Board of Health approval. We just need to get the approval from OSI. So once that happens, we'll get in there and drill the well. And then, God willing, we hit good water up there. So fingers crossed. But thank you. All right. Vacancies, zero. Approval of vouchers, general.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye, vote aye. Highway?
So moved.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye, vote aye. Continental Village Park District. Anybody?
So moved.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
And I vote aye. Continental Village Water District.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
And I vote aye. A motion to adjourn, please.
So moved.
Second. Meeting is adjourned.